We have next up Bev Heim-Myers, who will be moderating our session on patient preferences and clinical trial design. Welcome, Bev. Bev is the chair of the Canadian Coalition for Genetic Fairness and served as the CEO of Huntington Canada from 2010 to 2018, and then again as interim CEO from 2019 to 2020. We are also honored to have her as a member of the Clinical Trials Ontario Board of Directors. So welcome, Bev, good to see you, and I will hand this over to you.
Okay, thanks very much, Elise. It's great to be here. As Elise said, thank you very much for joining our session on including the patient preferences and perspective in clinical trial design. We will have four presentations today. Most of those presentations are pre-recorded. At the end of those presentations, we will invite all the presenters back to have a brief Q&A. So get your questions ready. We'll do that at the very end of the fourth session. When you're asking questions, if you wouldn't mind letting us know who you want that question directed to, that would be most helpful. Our first session today is titled Patient Preference to Inform Clinical Trial Design in Rheumatology. Our presenters will be Megan Thomas. Megan is a master's student at the Department of Community Health Sciences at the University of Calgary. And Megan will be joined by Lori Prue. Lori is a patient partner in Ottawa. I won't hold it up any longer, and I welcome Megan and Lori to the stage.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Megan Thomas, and I am a master's student at the University of Calgary, being supervised by Dr. Glenn Hazelwood.
Great, and my name is Lori Prue. I'm a patient partner, and I've been fortunate to work with Megan as well as Glenn on patient preference studies. And it sort of began, I guess, with some initial work that Glenn did on treatment tapering in people with rheumatoid arthritis. So as a person who has lived with rheumatoid arthritis for 30 years, I haven't been given many choices about my life. I was left with no choice over a diagnosis of JIA or the effect it had on my family. I don't control how my care is provided, and I can't write myself a prescription either. I can't get my insurance to pay for my very expensive medications, as well as other things in life. And I think this lack of choice really explains why research into patient preferences is really needed. It provides the choice to me when so often my choices have been taken away. I think it explains also how in healthcare design and delivery, patients are, and rightly so, asking to be more involved and engaged in decisions about their health.
As Lori mentioned, patients have insight to the experience of their health condition, and their preferences need to be valued when making any treatment decision. Clinical trials help generate evidence for treatments, and it is this evidence that must be considered by patients and their physicians when choosing the most appropriate course of treatment in a shared decision-making context. As the end users of treatments being researched, it's important to consider how to include patient preferences in the design and conduct of clinical trials.
Right. So as a patient, I'm constantly having to make a lot of difficult trade-offs between my life, which is represented here on the left-hand side, and my illness, which is represented on the right. So, you know, I'm a parent of two children, I'm married, I work, I have a regular job, I do, you know, I love to exercise. And I even briefly went back to school last year, and I'm constantly having to weigh, you know, what I want to do in life against my health and the many difficult decisions that I have to make. You know, there are decisions about, will this medication work for me? What are the side effects? Will those side effects interfere with my life in any way? There could be choices about monthly infusions versus injection. And how do I incorporate that with like a toddler at home. And you know, all these things that I've had to do over the course of my life. And I think this is where researchers and industry even in general can make some really meaningful impacts on patient lives. It helps them reconcile these often difficult trade-offs, hopefully at the end, making it easier for me to make these tough choices, or maybe present different options or treatments altogether that, you know, actually meet my needs. And so I do really think that research into patient preferences is a real opportunity to offer something different and unique for patients, beginning with the design of clinical trials.
In a healthcare context, a preference can be expressed by a patient regarding alternative management options or trade-offs related to healthcare decision-making. As Lori pointed out, there are many different considerations for a patient when making a treatment decision, each with different trade-offs for the patient. A patient may wonder about the safety of a treatment, whether a treatment will help them get better, whether a treatment has certain side effects, and then the overall compatibility of that treatment with their lifestyle. Ultimately, there are many questions that a patient may have when regarding a treatment, and their treatment choice should be aligned with their preferences. Luckily, there are already ways to measure patient preferences. Preference-based methods are defined as a way to quantify patient preferences by adding a value weight to the relevant trade-offs. They're often used in economic evaluation, but provide interesting insight in treatment decision-making in healthcare. Preference-based methods have been most applied in the interpretation stage of a trial, that is, after the trial has been conducted and the evidence collected. However, there are decisions when designing clinical trials where the evaluation of patient preferences may lead to improvements in how evidence is generated. Since its founding in 1992, OMERACT, or Outcome Measures in Rheumatology, has transformed outcome measurement in rheumatology clinical trials through consensus development with various stakeholders. Recognizing the potential of preference-based methods, OMERACT recently established a Patient Preferences in Rheumatology Clinical Trials Special Interest Group, composed of stakeholders all around the world. This group is made up of patients, rheumatologists, health economists, and epidemiologists who have all contributed to creating the research plan, reviewing materials, and reporting progress.
Right, and patients are an integral part to OMERACT and involved in each of the working groups that they have. And this actually happened well before patient engagement and research gained prominence in Canada and internationally. So they participate fully in the steering committee, I believe, of OMERACT, as well as all the different working groups. And so it was no different for our working group, where there were patient partners involved, and it wasn't just me. There were, you know, two from Canada, myself included, as well as Dawn Richards, and two from Europe, including the United Kingdom. So there was Pam Richards, as well as the Netherlands. Mariëkke Volschaar was her name. And so we provided advice on the development of the interview guide, the creation of this video that I've noted here, including the bit.ly link if you want to go take a look and take a look at this great video that Megan put together, as well as participating in the key informant interviews, as well as the virtual session that brought together all the different stakeholders, including opening it up to people, involved in other working groups at OMERACT.
As part of the work we're conducting for OMERACT, as well as for my master's thesis, we have been conducting research on patient preferences and trial design within rheumatology. First, we've conducted a scoping review of the literature to identify examples of ways quantitative preference-based methods have been applied to the design of clinical trials across health conditions. We identified 21 examples of studies that were using these methods, and the most common application to trial design has been to inform outcome development. Within our OMERACT group, we were able to use the examples pulled from this review and others provided by our team to conduct a live virtual session for stakeholder engagement within OMERACT. Participants identified key areas of interest and priority of including patient preference in trial design, specifically within outcome selection. The participants determined that including preferences is a priority regarding further explanation in order to develop comprehensive guidance. The next phase of our research will involve conducting one-on-one interviews with patients, clinicians, and rheumatologists in order to identify the different perceptions, barriers, and facilitators of using these methods within rheumatology. So as I mentioned, there were 21 studies included in the review. Within rheumatology, there are very few studies that are using these preference-based methods to actually inform trial design. They're often used to inform outcome evaluation. So there is a little bit of a gap that we've identified there.
Right. And it's interesting to me, too, from a patient perspective, is that, these are lifelong diseases, right? It's something that I'm going, I've lived with for 30 years, and it's, not going away. And that just means that there's so many different opportunities there to, help patients make those choices, to use those patient preferences to enable them to make decisions that work for them. So it represents a real opportunity, I guess, to try to address that gap and more systematically include patient preferences into the design of clinical trials.
The interview process is ongoing, but so far we've conducted 23 interviews, 6 with clinicians and researchers, and 17 with patients. Patients with any rheumatic condition were included, and we took an international approach to identify our participants in order to broaden our perspective. We're using a case-based approach to go through really specific examples that were identified from the review within our interviews in order to explore the different perceptions of our stakeholders. Initial findings have shown that patient preferences are deemed valuable to include, but that there are challenges when trying to do so in practice, particularly when it comes to trial design. One clinician participant identified that priorities are different when making treatment decisions, and this can impact and influence the way that trials are conducted. As noted by this patient participant here, patients have lived experience that makes them an expert in their own condition, and this supports the need to include their preferences in the design of trials. Patient participants also pointed out that these decisions impact their day-to-day lives, and thus they require sufficient information and opportunity to express these preferences upstream in the trial design stage. So while researchers play an important role in evaluating treatments, only patients understand the experience of living with their condition, and they must make decisions regarding their own care. Ideally, this research will help us find novel approaches to help integrate preferences into the conduct and design of trials.
Right. And from my perspective as a patient partner involved in this work, I really see patient preferences as an opportunity to offer something different to patients, right? To differentiate medications and treatments and to better meet the needs of us. As a patient, I'm hope that I won't be met with as many impossible choices, right? And truly, there are some really difficult choices I need to be made when I'm sitting with my rheumatologist or a healthcare professional in a clinical setting. It's never too early, I think, to incorporate patient perspectives or patient preferences into the design and conduct of clinical trials. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Megan and Lori. That was wonderfully informing. Our next session is focusing on the need for a holistic approach. The need for a holistic approach to acromegaly management. Our presenters will be Chantelle Gadol from Pfizer Canada and Deanna Badouk. Deanna is the president of Acromegaly Canada and a clinical trial participant. Welcome, Chantelle and Deanna.
Good afternoon.
Hi, my name is Chantal Cadieu. I work in rare disease at Pfizer Canada, and I'm very happy to have the opportunity to present today a patient preference study that we developed with ICON and with Canadian Acromegaly Patient Association, as well as with Acromegaly Community in the US. I'm joined today by the president of Acromegaly Canada, Deanna Badouk, who will present the study results. Acromegaly is caused by an excess production of growth hormone, which is usually the result of a benign pituitary adenoma. As shown on this figure, acromegaly has a broad impact across a wide spectrum of tissues and organs, and importantly, on the patient's general well-being and on quality of life. Interestingly, when we surveyed expert clinicians regarding their perspectives on the burden of disease, they readily recognized the significant comorbidities associated with acromegaly and the serious impact of this condition on patients' quality of life and well-being. However, while physicians recognized and appreciated the significant burden of disease, current clinical guidelines and practices place a high value on two quantitative clinical tests, which are laboratory measurements of IGF-1 and monitoring of tumor volume. In a separate study, we surveyed expert clinicians from multiple countries, including Canada, to rank the factors that they relied on for grading disease severity, so either as mild, moderate, or severe disease, and also for grading disease stability, so whether the disease was stable or required a change in clinical management. And not surprisingly, and in line with the clinical guidelines, the expert clinicians relied almost exclusively on IGF-1 laboratory values and tumor imaging for their clinical decision making. Their patient management approach, therefore, was focused on clinical variables and excluded the variables that may be relevant to patients, such as quality of life, signs and symptoms of the disease, or comorbidities. And even when biochemical control is achieved, so when IGF-1 levels are within the normal limits, for example, patients may still be experiencing disease-specific symptoms, such as fatigue, arthralgia, and a reduced quality of life, which means that the patient's perception of their health status could represent an important additional measure to assess the disease and make clinical decisions. Therefore, we set out to measure the patient's perspectives of their disease and how they would rank the different disease parameters, both the clinical ones and the patient-oriented ones, in regards to both disease severity and also when considering changes in the treatment approach. The ACROVOICE study was published in 2019, and the hypothesis we had was that the weight and the importance that patients would place on different disease attributes to drive their disease grading and clinical decision making may actually be different than that of the expert clinicians that were managing their care. Our hope was that by demonstrating this gap, this difference between clinicians and patients' perspectives on their disease and care, we may empower patients to engage in discussions with their clinicians based on the findings from this study that was conducted with a cohort of their peers. For those of you who may not be familiar with patient preference studies, the methodology and science has been around for a while, but there is growing recognition of the importance of these inputs into a variety of aspects of drug development, regulatory submissions, payer submissions, and also like this ACROVOICE study demonstrated and shown here in the red box, one important aspect is identifying similarities or gaps between clinician approaches to disease management and patient preferences for their clinical care. So, now I would like to turn over the remainder of the talk to Diana Badouk, President of Acromegaly Canada, who will be presenting the design of the study and the results. Thank you.
Thank you, Chantel. Hello, my name is Diana Badouk, and I am the founder and president of Acromegaly Canada. When I started discussing the research study with Pfizer, I was excited for the members to have the opportunity to contribute as the patient's voice, as this should be an important consideration when clinical decisions are being made, as a shared responsibility between the patient and their physicians. Some background. On the study, over a course of a few months, we enrolled 100 patients from Canada and the US. And as the demographic data here illustrates, there was representatives from Acromegaly Canada and Acromegaly Community. The average age was 50, and there were more women involved in the study. In addition, everyone was experienced with their acromegaly disease, the burden, for approximately 10 years. All that participated were very well educated. There was a number of methods employed in the patient preference study. For the AcroVoice, we employed a stated preference methodology in which preferences are assessed through choices from different alternatives in a survey setting. Prior to the survey, we needed to identify the attributes that patients identified as most relevant to their condition. And while the terminology used was different from the doctors, we found that the patients characterized their comorbidities of the signs and symptoms of their disease. We then incorporated the five variables into scenarios to identify the relative importance of these in the patient's perspective of the disease severity and disease stability. These were the results. We found that the patients placed an equal balance between traditional clinical variables and the patient-centered factors. This means that the imaging and laboratory testing, which is shown on the left side of this chart, should be importantly matched as just as important with the concerns for quality of life and related symptom conditions. Therefore, this study demonstrates that patients do understand their disease well and their perspective on what aspects of their conditions are important to them does have significant differences from the experts in this field. We hope that demonstrating this in a vigorous conducted research protocol, it will provide some evidence to help drive a shared clinical discussion decision between the patients and their physicians. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, Chantel and Deanna. We are moving to our next session, and this session will focus on clinical trials in pregnancy, a pandemic call to action. Our presenter will be Dr. Lauren Kelly. Dr. Kelly is Assistant Professor at the Department of Pediatrics and Child Health and Community Health Sciences at the University of Manitoba. Welcome, Dr. Kelly. I hand it over to you.
Wonderful. Thanks, Bev, and afternoon, everyone. Glad you could attend this session today. I'm going to be talking about clinical trials in pregnancy and a pandemic response call to action. As Bev mentioned, I'm an assistant professor in pediatrics at the University of Manitoba, and I come to this talk today really wearing two hats as someone who was pregnant during the pandemic. My second child was born in December, and as a clinical trialist and scientist who studies the safety of drugs during pregnancy, lactation, and throughout pediatrics. I am a research participant in several research studies and currently breastfeeding. We know that people who are pregnant require medication, and many pregnant people take medications for chronic conditions or acute health conditions that may occur or result from pregnancy. In the US, it's estimated that 9 out of 10 people are taking some form of medication while pregnant, and 7 in 10 of those are a prescription. There are many different factors that determine how an infant may respond, depending on the dose, the timing, and the types of medications that are used in pregnancy and throughout lactation. Pregnant women are drug orphans, and what that means is they're a subset of the population that is almost never included during drug development. While the topic of today is really mostly around pregnancy, just a reminder that medications are also needed throughout lactation, and people who are breastfeeding and chest feeding are almost always excluded from clinical trials as well. We know that most drugs will pass into breast milk in very small amounts, and half of the people who participated in the child study cohort, 41%, so almost half, reported taking at least one prescription medication while they were breastfeeding. terms of drug development, pregnancy is often, you know, not a focus of drug development pathways. So this study that was published in 2012 looks at industry-sponsored studies and found really that 95% of them were excluding pregnant people. And from 1995 to 2001, while there were almost 30 drugs approved for cardiovascular disease, where there were already a number of drugs for those conditions, only one was approved for a pregnancy-related condition. And less than 10% of medications have enough data on their product monographs to be able to adequately inform if they can be used safely during the perinatal period. Clinical trials in pregnancy are complex. Pregnant people themselves are medically complex, but pregnant people are capable of weighing risks and benefits and having informed discussions with healthcare providers and consenting to be included in clinical trials. The stakes, however, are very high. These include adverse events related to birth defects, pregnancy loss, prematurity, infant death, and developmental disabilities that can affect a family throughout, you know, a whole entire lifespan. A well-designed clinical trial, however, including several hundred pregnant people, prevents several thousands of pregnant people from participating in an uncontrolled, unmonitored experiment. And I think this is especially true during the COVID-19 pandemic, as we know now that many of the treatments and vaccines that are being used in the pregnant population were never studied for them in the population before they were approved. When I was first pregnant, we didn't know so much about the effects of COVID-19 in pregnancy. We know a lot more now. We know that pregnant women are at an increased risk for severe illness compared to people who are not pregnant. And it's advised by the CDC that pregnant people take all precautions to reduce their risks for getting COVID-19. A recent meta-analysis that came out just late last week, studied over 400,000 pregnant people, and they found that COVID-19 was associated with some very severe outcomes, including an increased risk for preeclampsia, increased admissions to the intensive care unit, increased preterm birth and stillbirth. And this is for any symptomatic or asymptomatic COVID. If they had severe COVID, they were even more strongly associated with these outcomes and other adverse pregnancy outcomes, including low birth weight and neonatal death. So when deciding to participate in a clinical trial when pregnant, we have to think about weighing, you know, the risks and benefits. So what are the risks of actually contracting COVID? And we now know that those risks in pregnancy are quite pronounced. And the risks of receiving a treatment that hasn't been studied in pregnancy or a vaccine for which we don't have safety data in pregnant people. Pregnant people get coronavirus at the same rate as the general population. This is not something that, you know, pregnant people aren't getting. We know that they are contracting it the same as the general population. Some studies in 2020, which seems like a long time ago now, looked at 927 clinical trials that were registered in the WHO registry for COVID, and only 1% of them were pregnancy specific. So most of them explicitly excluded pregnancy or failed to address pregnancy at all. So there's only 3 interventional trials that involve pregnant people. And these were 2 of the trials that I had a pleasure of playing a very small role in here in Manitoba early on in the pandemic when we thought hydroxychloroquine might be a effective treatment. And you'll notice that in these studies, we had 1 pregnant person in both of these trials, 6 that were breastfeeding in one trial and 3 that were breastfeeding in another. And there's a reason why there were so few pregnant and breastfeeding people enrolled in these studies that recruited in both Canada and the US. And the reason is that Health Canada actually wouldn't allow us to recruit pregnant people here in Canada. Hydroxychloroquine is a drug that we have ample safety data for other conditions in pregnancy. The FDA had done a safety review and had approved it for recruiting in pregnancy. And Health Canada said, nope, we don't know enough about hydroxychloroquine in pregnancy. You can't recruit pregnant people here. The WHO Solidarity Trial, for which we are recruiting here in Canada, I have the pleasure of serving as the co-PI for our sites here in Winnipeg. We didn't add pregnant people until the end of 2020, so, you know, almost 9 months into a pandemic, and none of the vaccine studies have included pregnant or lactating people to date. So what happened? We got all these great vaccines and they rolled out and workplaces says, nope, you know, if you're pregnant or lactating, you can't have the vaccine. My province, I live here in Winnipeg, said, nope, we're not vaccinating any pregnant people or breastfeeding people. Countries refused. The UK actually refused to vaccinate anyone who was pregnant or breastfeeding. The WHO advocated against vaccination in pregnancy. And this caused a lot of controversy. And being a pregnant person, it's really hard to weigh these decisions against what we see from the obstetrics and maternal fetal medicine community. And they really advocated for pregnant people to receive the vaccine, especially pregnant healthcare workers and frontline workers who are at increased risk of exposure. We saw a lot of amazing advocacy come out of ACOG and the Society of Obstetrics and Gynecologists of Canada and the Society for Maternal Fetal Medicine, challenging the WHO's decision and really advocating that pregnant people are capable of providing informed consent. And so this decision, I can't comment on all workplaces. I'm not sure if there are still some places that are not advocating for vaccinations in pregnancy, but thankfully these decisions have been reversed. So here in Manitoba, there's a very long consent form, but we are eligible and actually being prioritized for vaccinations. And there's some data to support safety now. So this is the V-Safe data out of the US. I believe there's been more than 35,000 pregnant people that have been vaccinated now, almost 2,000 in this registry. And this is the data from the first 275 completed pregnancies. And I just wanted to highlight that really we don't see any increases in miscarriage, stillbirth, pregnancy complications or neonatal complications, higher than we would expect in the general population not receiving vaccines. And in February, Pfizer and BioNTech registered their first pregnancy trial for vaccines. They're recruiting 4,000 people. It should be completed next June. Harvard has launched an international registry called C-Viper, and UBC launched one here in Canada called the CanCOVID Vaccine Registry. So if anyone is pregnant or lactating currently and they think they might get the vaccine at some point, you can register and you can just Google search for that registry if you're interested. And several provinces, including here in Manitoba, have now prioritized vaccinating people who are pregnant. I'm not going to talk much about the safety, but if you're looking for more information, the ACOG website has tons of great and accessible information about vaccines in pregnancy. So, you know, I think it's really important that we talk about pregnancy in clinical trials because pregnancy outcomes affect everyone. You know, all of us are here because of a pregnancy. And so I think, you know, we really need to be prioritizing things like developmental and reproductive toxicology studies. So in the context of COVID, these trials took a back burner. These studies really got done late in drug development. You know, I think, you know, especially in a public health crisis when lots of pregnant people are going to be exposed, we need to prioritize these studies and they need to be done earlier and they need to be mandated before something is approved. The ethics of excluding pregnant people was really brought to light during COVID. You know, we went from a situation where we didn't really know much about the risks of COVID in pregnancy to a situation where we know that there are a lot of risks to contracting COVID and a lot of adverse outcomes associated with it. And we need to be able to adequately inform people when they're participating in clinical trials or considering participating what those risks and benefits might be and what are also the unknowns. So what are the things that we wish we had data about but we simply don't know at the time of the trial? More work is urgently needed here in Canada to advocate, incentivize, and mandate companies to study drugs with pregnant people, for pregnant people, you know, anything that's going to be used in that population. In the United States in 2017, the Cures Act established the Task Force for Research specific to pregnant women and lactating women, or PregLact. And this is a group that identifies gaps in research and therapeutics for pregnant people and lactating people. And the NIH has an obstetrics and pediatrics pharmacology and therapeutics branch. And I'd really advocate and urge Health Canada and the Public Health Agency of Canada to support that kind of work here for Canadian women. So a very quick summary, you know, forcing people who are pregnant and lactating to take untested medications, thumbs down, allowing pregnant and lactating people to make informed decisions and participate in clinical trials, thumbs up. So with that, I'll just end the session and I'm happy to take any questions during the panel.
Thanks very much, Dr. Kelly. Now we're on to our fourth and final session before we come back for a Q&A, a live Q&A. Our next session is focusing on the go-kart approach to patient engagement in an early phase clinical trial. Our presenters will be Terry Harish. Terry is a patient advocate and volunteer with Leukemia Lymphoma Society of Canada. And Dr. Manoj Lalu. Dr. Manoj is an associate scientist at Clinical Epidemiology and Regenerative Medicine Programs at Ottawa Hospital Research Institute. Welcome, Terry and Dr. Manoj.
Hello. On behalf of my co-presenter, Dr. Manoj Lalu, we would like to thank Clinical Trials Ontario for the opportunity to speak today, and would like to recognize them for their continued efforts in providing some great information and resources to the patient and public and to further their understanding of clinical trials. My name is Terry Harish. I'm a 10-year survivor of an aggressive form of blood cancer. I've been exposed to the good and the bad of our healthcare system, and upon reflecting on these experiences, it's driven me to want to contribute to the creation of a more positive and effective cancer journey for those who are similarly afflicted. As such, I'm currently active as a patient partner with the Ottawa Hospital Research Institute, collaborating and advising on various clinical research programs, such as the one we'll talk about today. And I'm also a patient advocate and volunteer with the Leukemia Lymphoma Society, a member of Clinical Trial Ontario's College of Lived Experience, and also a semi-retired engineer by trade. So what is go-kart? Go-kart is simply getting better outcomes with chimeric antigen receptor T-cell therapy. Yes. So go-kart represents a clinical research program centered at the Ottawa Hospital Research Institute that's utilized patient engagement to help translate and clinically apply bench-to-bedside research associated with a promising new class of personalized immunotherapy treatment for blood cancers called chimeric antigen receptor T-cell therapy, also known as CAR-T therapy. And for those who don't know about CAR-T therapy, it involves the harvesting of patients' T-cells, genetically modifying them in a laboratory environment to target and attack cancer cells. And the T cells are then readministered into a patient's body to do its work. So a major outcome of the go-kart program is focusing on the incorporation of patient engagement into the development of an early phase clinical trial protocol or design for the first Canadian-led clinical trial called CLIC-01 of CAR-T to assess its safety and effectiveness. So how is this done? Well, to achieve this, researchers have applied an integrated knowledge translation approach that involves using knowledge users such as patients as equal partners to ensure the design of the clinical trial protocol is relevant and useful to those knowledge users. And this was done utilizing a integrated knowledge translation framework called the Accelerator Framework, which involves five core projects to evidence inform the clinical trial protocol. So what does this look like? And here it is. So depicted in the slide is what it looks like, and briefly describes each one of the five core projects where patients contributed as patient partners. And in chronological order, starting with the preclinical and clinical systematic reviews, working into a project called implementation diagnostics, looking at barriers and enablers, to clinical trial participation, and then an early economic analysis looking at the cost effectiveness of CAR T therapy, retrospective cohort study estimating eligible participants and event rates, and then finally the testing project concerning the testing of the product itself. And all this led to the feedback coming out of this where patients were involved led to the delivery of a more informed clinical trial. So looking at each one of these projects in a little bit more detail to look at how patients contributed and some of the outcomes, starting with the preclinical and clinical systematic review, we helped develop a plain language summary of all the current evidence in CAR T, and which would help inform and optimize the trial design. We also, upon reviewing all this information, we've noted that patient outcomes are really, really underreported. Things such as quality of life and side effects from a patient standpoint. And we certainly advocated that they should be included in the CLIC 01 trial protocol, and they certainly were. The next project being the implementation diagnostics, a very important topic concerning patient participation in clinical trials, and ensuring that enough patients are recruited and retained to be able to make this a success. So this study, we created a survey sent to the blood cancer patient community to solicit their feedback related to what they perceived as enablers and disablers associated with that clinical trial recruitment and participation. For the survey, we inputted into the survey guide, helped with interviewee recruitment, reviewed the results with the research team, and helped them confirm specific themes that were important to the trial design in this regard, which inevitably led to this effort's being able to complete this survey. We were able to help increase the recruitment of all the interviewees, which helped, of course, reveal key barriers to participation that, as I say, were very, very important and fed back into the trial protocol. Early economic analysis. Yes, CAR T therapy is a very expensive therapy. We did advise on the early in development cost effectiveness and commercial economic evaluation of the CAR T therapy. So specifically, we identified costs that patients identify as critical to them undergoing such treatments, and these are costs such as monetary and non-monetary costs, impacts on lifestyle, et cetera, that we felt drived, the economics in a significant way, and many of those aspects could be quantified to help with the analysis. So we also, to gain some additional wider loop of feedback, helped to create patient stakeholder sessions for a wider input from the blood cancer patient community for this model. The retrospective cohort study project, unfortunately, we didn't get much chance to participate in this, but we did attend meetings and we did discuss results of this with the researchers. The production and testing of the cell product project, very, very technical. Couldn't really provide too much input as a patient partner, but we did attend meetings on the subject and furthered our knowledge on the topic. So a couple of other interesting things supplementary to the go-kart program that the patient's partners were involved with was creating resources that would be important to patients that would be undergoing the clinical trial, such as this information sheet, which is answering some basic questions that patients do have about the clinical trial in clear, concise, non-technical language, enabling them to make more informed choices during, say, the informed consent process, or even during, you know, the navigation of the clinical trial if they are participants. Here is a another creation of our patient partner's artistic ability with the researchers, of course, at a glance view of the clinical trial process, showing the visits, visit details, whether or not you should bring caregivers with you, what's specifically happening at each during each one of these visits, whether there's blood draws, imaging, etc. And again, a great resource that patients can use to ensure that they're informed properly prior to consenting. And again, a great navigation tool and resources, not only for the patients, but for the caregivers and family members. So in summary, some positive outcomes to the patient community, more relevant research results were achieved using patient engagement. The knowledge and lived experience of blood cancer patients was valued as important input, which was very gratifying. And specifically, patient engagement in the study resulted in issues important to the patient being built into the clinical trial design, a more realistic early economic modeling, improved recruitment retention by understanding the barriers enablers to the clinical trial, more effective therapy designed by knowledge users for knowledge users. And the long and short of this again is that it allows patients to make better informed decisions on CAR T therapy. And you know, patients are the key ultimate end users and customers of publicly funded research, and patient engagement helped to customize the research to areas of patient community interest and priority. So I just wanted to briefly acknowledge this wonderful group of people, researchers and other patient partners that I had the opportunity to work with, and a great group, and I learned a lot from them and had just a wonderful experience. Thank you very much, and look forward to your questions and answers later.
Thank you very much, Terry, and also thank you to Dr. Lalu for his contribution. Now I would like to invite all of the panelists back for our live Q&A session. I think we're all here. Okay, so we have one question. Our first question is for all of you. And I'm just waiting for one more, Dr. Lalu. Great presentations. There we go.
Oh,
welcome, Dr. Lalu.
Okay. Sorry about that. Juggling kids. That's
fine. Okay, so our first question is for all of you, or whoever wants to answer it. What advice do you have for those who are interested in patient preference in their clinical trials? What steps should they take to do this, and what should they be mindful of? Who wants to go? You can raise your hand if you want to start.
Yeah, I might as well. Since I think it would probably be a nice segue to everyone else. But I mean, speak with patients, right? Obviously, that's my bias. But I think, you know, starting with the patient experiences, try to understand, I guess, the sorts of situations that they do face, you know, every day. And I mean, that was, you know, similar to, that was a similar approach, I think, taken with, you know, Megan and her supervisor, Dr. Glenn Hazelwood, where it sort of started with a smaller project, right? Just to understand, you know, what are the sort of circumstances that they're facing day to day, and then trying to use that to inspire the researcher to build the research direction from there. So
I have one small piece of advice for researchers, and that's really, can you hear me? I'm getting some feedback.
Yes, Dr.
It's
Kelly.
Not to offer preferences that you can't act on. So, you know, if you are studying a particular intervention, don't ask patients what intervention you want them to study, because they may tell you they don't want to study that. And so don't give them options of things that you're not willing to act on and change in your trial design. So, you know, ask for feedback really early when you're designing these studies, and ask for things that you can really actually implement and act on their feedback. Because I think that's really important, that you provide your patient partners with actual meaningful use of their experience.
So Dr. Kelly, how early is early?
Like when you're thinking about writing a grant, you know, when you get an idea, because you may find out that that really isn't relevant to them, or maybe someone else they know is already doing that, but as early as that idea pops in your mind.
Maybe also,
Chantel.
Yes. So yeah, involving them as early as possible. I was going to say that as well, but also try to have as much as possible a good diversity, a good representation of patients, and maybe not, if possible, not only one patient, but, you know, a good group of patients.
Thank you. Yes, Dr. Lalu.
Well, I was just going to quickly add that there's lots of resources out there now as well, too, for researchers who are interested in pursuing patient engagement. So CTO, the website, actually has some excellent resources on there that can help people get started. And then SPOR as well, through CIHR, has some excellent resources as well to get started.
Thank you. Did anybody else want to add anything to that before we go to the next question? I don't see any. Megan, did you want to?
Sure. Yeah, I agree with everything that's been said. I think it's important to start as early as possible, really embed preferences in the process of clinical trials, to make sure that you're not taking that tokenistic approach and kind of just asking them after you've already developed a protocol and just sort of want them to agree with what you've already written. I think it's really important to get that insight. So really connecting with patient groups, patient-led organizations, and making sure that you have that adequate representation and diversity that Chantel mentioned as well. Yeah, I think that sort of sums it up.
Thank you. Yes, Deanna.
In the beginning, when we, you know, get involved with research studies and, you know, you're finding your patients in that, giving them a little description of what research study is about, and maybe asking them, like, is there something that you think that you could possibly put forward to help with even more detailed stuff in the research study, coming from the patient, would be great too, right? And like you said, then putting it all together prior to doing the research study to find the more relevant, really important questions that really important questions have maybe been overlooked by the research study team.
From a diverse input perspective. I'll just add this to it. Is it important to have a caregiver opinion when you're moving forward in developing the clinical trials? Or do you not, or does it depend on what it's for? Just real quickly. Lori, I sort of saw you nodding.
No, I think Deanna had her hand up, but it's okay, I can go after her.
Oh, Deanna, I'm sorry. What do you think, Deanna? Is it important?
I do think it's important because... I do think it's important to have the caregiver's opinion too, because they actually see stuff that the patient doesn't see. Like how we're feeling, maybe we're just because we feel that way all the time, we just take it as that's the way it is, but they could actually see, oh, wow, you know that my spouse is actually having a really bad day compared to like just a normal day of living with a disease, right? And I think their input would be really good too in research.
Thank you. Our next question is for Lauren. What do you think of the reason for excluding pregnant, lactating women from trials due to hormonal variations, et cetera?
So,
Dr. Kelly.
Yeah, I think the reason for exclusion is not necessarily due to hormones. I think it's more due to the absolutely high risks of if something does go wrong. So, you know, there was lots of publicity around the thalidomide crisis, which was a drug that was marketed in Europe and marketed for morning sickness, and of course resulted in a lot of amputated limbs in the children that were being born. And I think no company really wants to be associated with, you know, being the company that caused, you know, any teratogenic or birth defects. I think there's a lot of fear there about worst case scenarios. And we know in pregnancy, adverse pregnant outcomes happen anyways, things like miscarriages and stillbirths. And I think that causes a lot of fear from a company perspective in terms of investing in drug development for pregnancy. And then I also think there's a lot of logistical and operation, you know, logistical operational challenges, things like, you know, most pregnant people are seen by general practitioners or in a small obstetrics practices. There's not clinical trial infrastructure built in there. It's not, you know, like if you're an oncology patient in hospital, a lot of times, you know, clinical trials are part of what they do. And I don't think we're there yet in terms of obstetrics and family medicine here in Canada. So I think there's a lack of infrastructure. And then challenges about ethically, you know, how do you ensure that someone is informed about these potential really high risk events? And so a lot of it is unknowns and conveying that information and ensuring that pregnant and lactating people are informed of these risks is also a challenge. So I'm not sure it's due to hormones, but there's definitely lots of reasons why they've been excluded so far.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Kelly. A new question for all of you. Do you see emerging interest from patients for more technological solutions and trials, such as being able to fill out QOLs either at home or on a tablet in a clinic? I thought
that was your hand. From in our trials, you know, our parents are always saying they want to fill it out like in the car while they're at soccer practices or they're on the toilet, you know, at a break from work. Definitely electronic ways are the way of the future for outcome measurement tools, especially ones that need to be completed regularly.
Yeah, I mean, I can speak from a patient perspective that I think it... Yeah, I would just say from a patient perspective, it does add probably a great deal of simplicity, and you know, it probably would reduce the need for sort of site visits and these sorts of things, so to bring the research to them instead of having to go into a site or into hospital or wherever it's being run to actually complete the job. So just being more patient friendly overall. So I would say it's a positive development.
Thank you, Lori. Okay, another question, and this question is for Chantal. Sometimes industry sponsors are worried about working with patient partners and the regulations. Is there any advice that you can provide others from industry about that?
Yeah, this is a very, very good question, because it's true that it's complex. And, you know, when we're working with pipelines or drugs that are not approved in Canada, we have to be very careful with the way we talk to people about those drugs, obviously, because it cannot be seen as any as promotional in any way, obviously. So we are extremely, extremely careful. We have some compliance departments, and every activity that we do, we run it through some, through our colleagues and our compliance colleagues to make sure that the activities are correct and that we can do them. But I agree, it's something that we have to think of, and that is very, it's a very good question. Yeah.
Thank you. I do have a question for you, Dr. Kelly. It's difficult enough often being pregnant and the worry with being pregnant. Is it difficult to recruit patients for trials? Sometimes it's difficult for industry or to get it approved, but what's it?
Yeah, so I think certainly there's challenges in finding people who are pregnant. There's not really an advocacy group. You can't go to sort of a society for a specific disease and find an existing group of patients that have a particular condition. And because obviously you're pregnant for a certain period and then you're not pregnant anymore, that population group changes, right? And so I think you can always get feedback from people who have been pregnant, from their experiences, whether that be 5 years ago or a couple months ago. But certainly, there are some challenges in finding participants and consenting them, especially early in pregnancy when there is still that really big concern for miscarriages or stillbirths. Obviously, those happen very frequently. And so I think, especially early in pregnancy, that's probably even more difficult. But perhaps later on in pregnancy, you might have a better time.
Thank you. So before we wind down, does anybody have one brilliant piece of advice or nugget for those that are listening to us today when it comes to patient engagement in clinical trials?
I think it's really important to have the patient's voice in clinical trials, because it helps to close the gap and to have a better understanding and a more solid understanding of the reality of just life, depending on the research.
Thank you. Not to mention retention, mm-hmm. if you consider the patient. Well, thank you very much, everybody, for your contribution to all the panelists. Thank you very much for your time and for your contribution today. And thank you very much to all of you watching. Please enjoy the rest of the Clinical Trial Ontario Conference. Thanks for joining us.